Good morning. Welcome to Centennial Park Baptist Church. And at this time, we're going to play our national anthem. Especially welcome you this Sunday. If you're online with us, welcome. It's nice seeing Pastor Chris with us. Today we can brag that we have a plethora of pastors with us, all because we are a big priesthood. I'd just like to make some announcements aware of everybody here so you don't overlook them. There's a nice calendar in our book for you to use. But most importantly, the ladies' Bible study this week has been deferred 1 week, 7 days, till July 11th, 1:30. Our congregational prayer meeting is going to go on July 4th at 10 o'clock. And we're starting a new summer Bible series, and it's starting on Wednesday, July 27th. And you can see the church office or the secretary to get your book, and you're going to answer a few questions when you're done there, and it's why I still. And our monthly offerings are put in there to make us aware of it and for us to pray over. But it's a great day today, and I just realized it when I sat down and came into the church that Rita Dennis is going to be 95, actually, on July 9th. Yeah. She had to put up with me for 50 years, so she needs prayer. It's also to celebrate John and Michelle Klein's 34th anniversary today. Congratulations, John and Michelle. They'll work it out. They've got this far. They'll work it out. But I remember today is also a very important day, because it's my youngest grandson's birthday. He's 9 years old today. So Ezra, happy birthday. You gotta watch it to find it. The office is gonna be closed Monday. Make a note of Janet Fletcher's new address, because if you go to her old address, you probably won't find her. And if there's any other questions, phone the office and we're all good to go. And I believe that's it. No questions? Great.
Good morning, Centennial Park. I'm going to ask if you are able to please stand and join us in praising and worshiping our God. To you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. Face the day, and in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. Face the day, and in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us.
Away.
139, verses 1 to 18. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Even there your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well.
My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you.
We're going to ask the ushers if they'll come forward at this time for our tithes and offerings, and I'll pray as they get up here. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for you blessing us, just blessing us abundantly with so much, Lord. We just want to return it unto you, Lord, as our witness and testimony of how great you are, Lord, in your provision for us, in your adoration for us, for it was you who said at creation, it was good. Lord, help us to honor you and bless you with all that we have, Lord. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'd like to ask you all to rise for our next two praise songs.
My heart, I'm coming back to
about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, when it's all about you, Jesus, I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's all about you. Yes, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, yes, it's all about you, Jesus.
Good morning. Been a long time since I've been up here, but it's good to be here. And it's good to see all of you. Yeah, so we have some praise items and prayer items. We do praise God for Pastor Chris' successful hip replacement surgery. And we just pray that God's healing for Pastor Chris as he goes to physio appointments and does daily exercises. We are thankful for Gary's Uncle Paul Russell as he is preaching to us today. And we'll be anticipating Pastor Barry's preaching in a couple of Sundays. So we just praise the Lord for our great country of Canada and for the many freedoms we enjoy as Canadians. And we just remember the Heidman family in the passing of Mr. Heidman. We just pray that you'll be with Don, Kathy, Kathy's father, and Brent's grandfather, Bert Heidman. We are thankful Bert knew Jesus as his Lord and Savior and is now free of suffering and is in heaven. Please pray for Bruce Taylor, who is recovering at home from a stroke, and for Janet as she awaits a specialist appointment at the end of August. Please continue to uphold Linda Bielik in prayer. We pray for Janet Berry's son, Scott, and his upcoming appointment with the oncologist and his surgery at the end of June, which has happened, I guess. Please pray for Sue McCullough's friend as she prays and seeks God's will concerning a mission trip to Thailand or the Ukraine. Please pray for the pastors and deacons of this church as we endeavor to shepherd this flock. And we just pray for our new sister church, the Mississauga Grace Missionary Church. We do pray for the Ukrainian refugees coming to Canada. We also pray for the Ukraine and the struggles they're going through. And God willing, we'll never have to face that. And we continue to pray for Dewan and Don and Sue McCullough, for Pat Raymond Wood, Jade's dad, Rolly Lopez, Bruce Taylor, Conrad Marie Franklin, Mary Moda, Gloria Park, Michelle Klein's sister Sue, Eden Sawyer, Rob Hepburn, Belle Hales, Rita Dennis. We just pray, Lord, that your healing hand will be upon each and every one of them. Bless them this day, Heavenly Father. Bless us as we anticipate your word as Paul brings it to us this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. The last few times that I've been here, we've been going through the Psalms. Normally, Pastor Chris is not here when I'm here. So I tried to give him my notes this morning, but he wouldn't take them. So something about he can't stand and walk as effectively as he used to be able to. We've been looking at the Psalms. The first time I was here, we looked at Psalm 1, a wisdom psalm. Two different paths, two different choices to make. Which path are you going to take? And the psalm says that that you can choose the right path. You can choose the path of wisdom. So that was a wisdom psalm. We also looked at Psalm 32. From David's experience with his sin with Bathsheba, he fell into sin. He did some terrible things. Psalm 51 is that emotional, immediate response of David's heart, asking God to forgive him of that sin. And then Psalm 32 is a maskil, a teaching psalm. David wanted to take his experience from Psalm 51 and put it in a form that would teach people about forgiveness. So we looked at that, a teaching psalm or a maskil. We looked at Psalm 22, which is a messianic psalm, a description of the work or the life of Christ in the Old Testament. But we also looked at what it meant to David, because if you understand the Old Testament in its context, then that breaks forth the Word of God and we can better understand how it applies to Christ. And last time I was here, we looked at Psalm 126, 15 Psalms of the Psalter, dealing with the ascent of the people of God to Mount Zion, to Jerusalem. When they came to Jerusalem up to three times a year for festivals or for sacrifice. And Psalm 126 was that worship psalm going and ascending to the temple. Today we want to look at a psalm of praise, a psalm of adoration, Psalm 8. It's a hymn of praise, a time of expressing your joy to God as Creator, who is our provider and sovereign over all. So if you can go to the next slide. Don't know if you remember 2003. 2003, I was coming back from a conference of North American representatives for SIM, and as we got to Detroit, the plane turned around and we returned to the state that we were leaving from. We found out that most of Ontario, Quebec, the Northern Hemisphere, all went into darkness. You may remember that time, 3 days, I think it was in Stouffville, that the power was off. But the blessing of that was that people for the first time in Toronto were able to see the stars. And they were able to look into the night sky and see all the glorious things that God had put there. 40 years ago, I was up at Camp Kakika, Christian Service Brigade Camp. And up at Camp Kakika, we were able to, at night, see the stars. And one night, after I had done all the program work, the boys had gone to bed, the counselors with them in the cabins, and I was alone, and I used to go out onto the waterfront, onto the diving board, and look up into the stars, look up into the sky, and have just a quiet, peaceful time. And the Lord blessed me that night with Aurora Borealis, the Northern Lights. And I had to decide, as program director, do I wake up the camp so that they can see this unusual event? I won't tell you what I did, but the boys didn't get to see it. In Zambia, if you think the stars in Canada are fantastic, you need to go to the Southern Hemisphere to see the Milky Way and to see the stars in the Southern Hemisphere. It is just so much better in many ways because of the stars and the brightness and all the things that you can see. Zambia, of course, has Victoria Falls, that great falls, one of the wonders of the world. We were in game parks. We saw the Big Five. One of the blessings that I have in being able to travel to over 70 countries around the world now is to see the natural beauty of the earth, to be able to have seen, as we expressed last time I was here, the Andes, the Alps, the Rockies, the Himalayas, Mount Kenya, to be able to see God and his creation and all of the things that God has placed there for us. It was at looking at God's creation one night, possibly, that David, being immersed in what God had created, his experience in seeing creation, soaking all of that in from the hillsides of Judea, that he, out of that expression, out of that time, wrote Psalm 8. We don't know when he wrote it exactly. We don't know what the exact occasion was, but it was, we can see in that expression, his heart. We can see what seeped out of him after having absorbed the creation and what he saw. And so the question that we have that the psalmist asks in Psalm 8 is, what is man? As he looks at the creation, as he looks at what all God has done, what is man? And he begins in this psalm with an adoration, with praise for God's creation, the beauty of the creation, not for its own sake, but because the presence of God in creation gives it meaning, gives it purpose. And then the psalm begins with that comment about God, and sandwiched in between a comment about God and a comment ending the psalm with God, the psalmist in verses 3 to 8 talks about man, and he has some comments about man. In other words, the psalmist's perspective of God leads him to a view about man, which leads him back to a meditation upon God. In other words, you can't know man apart from God. Psalm 8, it says this, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You've set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, what you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of him? Human beings that you care for them? You've made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds and the animals of the wild, the birds of the sky, and the fish of the sea, all that swim in the paths of the sea. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. When I was teaching at the Theological College in Zambia, and I had our first year students, and we were teaching them methods of Bible study, one of the first things that we tried to drill in their heads is observe, observe, observe. What does the text say? And it's important to note in this psalm what the text says. And I hope that you saw that in the very first line, Lord, our Lord, Lord is written in two different ways. And the problem in English is that we don't have as many words to translate the Hebrew. But what the editors of the scripture have tried to do is tried to indicate that we're dealing with two different names of God in this opening verse. Lord, in all caps, is Yahweh. And Lord, with a capital L, is Adonai. And what the psalmist is doing and what he's going to do in the psalm is he's going to draw from the creation experience, draw from the creation narrative that we have in Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2. In Genesis chapter 1, if you look at that, at some point you will see in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And all throughout the first chapter of Genesis, the word that's used for God is Elohim, God in its plural form, God who is the Lord of all, God who is the majestic one, God who is the creator. And then as we get into the second chapter of Genesis, where Moses gives us the second perspective of creation, creation from a different viewpoint, he changes the name of God from Elohim to the one who is over his creation, the one that created all things, to Yahweh, to Lord. Because in chapter 2, what Moses does is he says, God is in relationship with man. We're introduced to this name of God in the Old Testament when Moses was brought to the burning bush. And Moses said, who should I say is sending me? And the Lord said, I am that I am. Yahweh, the personal name of God. In fact, it's so personal, it's so relational, that when the Jews still come to this particular word as they're reading the Old Testament, they substitute the name of Yahweh for Adonai because they feel that they're unworthy to use the most personal name of God. But David says, O Lord, Yahweh, our Lord, Adonai, these two names. Man is in relationship with God. Yet God is the creator of all things. And then David goes on to say, how excellent or majestic is your name. Now, when we were having our daughters, we struggled with what to name our girls. We didn't know at that point whether we were having a boy or a girl, so we picked out a boy's name and we picked out a girl's name. And my wife and I disagreed on what kind of name we should choose. I wanted it to be a biblical name. She wanted it to be something a little bit more majestic. There's something in a name, and there's something in the name of God. It's more than just an identification. It's more than just a label. It's synonymous with his revealed character. In the African context, after you've been known by the people, they give you a name, which reflects your character. Sometimes they tell you what the name is. Sometimes they don't, because a name is not going to be that flattering. But the name of God is important because it reflects his character, it reflects his nature, it reflects who he is. And God is all and all. And how majestic is his name? How majestic is his character? It reveals God. And so what the psalmist is saying is that as you look at creation, you can see God, you can see his character, you can see who he is. Paul writes concerning this in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 20. He writes to them, he says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even the eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." We talked about last time I was here about some of the people that are coming and wanting to join SIM, and we look at their theological background, and we dig a little bit into what their understanding of the scriptures are. And we have had some people come and say, well, if God doesn't reveal himself in who he is, then there are people that don't really need to receive Jesus because he's a gracious God and he's just going to allow them to come into heaven because they've never heard. And what Paul says here to the Romans is, men are without excuse, because as you look at the heavens, as you look at the handiwork of God, as you look at creation, you see his revealed character. And that is sufficient to condemn all men and women in this world. It's sufficient to send them to hell because they are without excuse. God's glory is also displayed or exhibited in another form. David says, creation shows the power of God. Creation reveals his character. Creation reveals who he is. But look at verse 2. From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. Praise to God is not chanted just on high in the heavens, but it also echoes in the cradle and in the nursery. We see here a challenge to God. There are people who are against God, and the challenge of God's enemies is met by these little ones. The challenge is met by the weak infants, the immaterial mouth, and the immature. From the voice of these children, a free response of trust and love, such as a child's confession, is a devastating answer to the accuser. A devastating answer, and it's part of the arsenal that we can battle against doubts and slanders. I can't remember now the exact thing that I was worried about, but one of my daughters is sensitive, very sensitive, and she came up to me as a little girl and said, "Daddy, what's wrong?" And in the best way that I could, I tried to tell her what was wrong. And her response was, "Daddy, God will take care of it. God will take care of it." From the mouths of little ones, he silences the foe and the avenger. Matthew, in his gospel, in Matthew 21, verses 12 to 16, tells us that Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. "It is written," he said to them, "my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers." The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. "Do you hear what these children are saying?" they asked him. "Yes," Jesus replied. "Have you never read, from the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise?" From babes and children, God's character is revealed. God uses the simple to confound the wise. And the basic lesson here is, don't underestimate the ability of our children to understand God's word, not just because they don't have the same sinful experience that we have, because God uses them often to speak. Jesus says in Matthew 18:3, "Unless you become as one of these, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven." Unless you become like a little child, with that childlike faith, which brings acceptance, that simple acceptance of who God is, The purpose of this source of revelation, David says, is to silence God's enemies. And based on this understanding of God, the psalmist makes a statement concerning man. He says, this is who God is. This is who we can understand God to be. God has revealed himself in these two ways. But based on my understanding of who God is, verse 3, in light of the vastness and the immensity of creation, the psalmist feels insignificant. I don't know if you've ever felt that way when you were by yourself and you're looking up at the stars and you just felt, who am I? In the midst of all this vastness, in the midst of all that God has done, who am I? That's what the psalmist says. When I consider the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man, that you care for him? The question in verse 4 is asked in other passages as well. What is man that you are mindful of him? In Psalm 144, verses 38, the answer comes back mocking the arrogance of the rebel. It says, man is like to vanity. His days are a shadow that passeth away. Bow thy heavens, O Lord, and come down. Touch the mountains, and they shall smoke. Cast forth lightning and scatter them. Shoot out thine arrows and destroy them. Send thine hand from above. Rid me and deliver me out of great waters from the hand of strange children, whose mouth speaketh vanity, and their right hand is a right hand of falsehood. Or in Job chapter 7, verses 17 to 18, the sufferer, the one who has gone through all kinds of things, asks, what is man? And he says, what is man that thou shouldst magnify him, and thou shouldst seat thine heart upon him, and thou shouldst visit him every morning and try him every moment? Why? What is man? Why am I suffering? Or in Job 25, verses 4 to 6, Job shudders at sin and man's condition, asking the same question. How then can man be justified with God? Or how can he be clean that is born of a woman? Behold, even to the moon, and it shineth not. Yea, the stars are not pure in his sight. How much less man that is a worm, and the son of man, which is a worm? This passage is different. Asking the same question, what is man that thou art mindful of him? The fact that God is mindful and that he thinks about man, that he is remembering man, not cognitive facts. When we were young, we, as a youth group, we liked the passage where God knows the number of hairs on our head, not the number of heads that we have, but the number of hairs on our head. In more recent years, I'm not as impressed with that verse, because it takes a whole lot less time to count them. But it's not the cognitive facts of remembering that the psalmist is talking about here. In Exodus chapter 2:24, and God heard the groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. In the Old Testament, when God remembers, God acts. And that's what David is saying here. What is man that you are mindful, that you're remembering him? Why is it that you are going to act towards him? The fact is that when God remembers, he will act. The King James says that you visit him. The Hebrew word there is to visit. But the question is, when God visits, does he visit in which of two ways? Does he visit in terms of mercy, or does he visit in terms of wrath? And the context determines what kind of visit God is going to do. In Hosea chapter 1, verse 4, God visits with wrath. And the Lord said unto him, call his name Jezreel for yet a little while, and I will avenge the blood of Jezreel upon the house of Jehu, and will cause to cease the kingdom of the house of Israel. I remember, and I will act, and my act is going to be an act of judgment. But God remembers, and he acts, and he also acts in mercy. Ruth chapter 1, verse 6. And then she arose with her daughters-in-law, and that she might return to the country of Moab. For she'd heard that the country of Moab had how the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. God visited his people, and this time he visited his people with mercy, with grace. So here the psalmist is saying God is going to visit, but it's a context that determines what kind of visit it's going to be. And the context is clear. God is visiting with his mercy, with his grace. There's four statements that he makes here. In verse 5, he has been made a little lower than the... And I struggled when I was reading the scriptures there from the NIV because they've translated the word Elohim as angels. And that's what most of your scriptures say, because the Septuagint, the LXX, uses the Greek word angelos, angels, and puts it into the Old Testament. Because that's what the author of Hebrews uses in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 4, being made so much better than the angels, he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. And the word in the text here is Elohim. And it is possible that Elohim could be angels. But the context would say no. David isn't saying that man is created a little bit lower than angels. The word is Elohim. David is saying man is created a little bit lower than God. Because David is rooting his thoughts here back in Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2. Man is created in God's image and after his likeness. His comment is how man was created in the original state. He was crowned with glory and honor. And when you're crowning someone with glory and honor, these are unique attributes. These are unique descriptions of God. They express royal dignity. Psalm 24, verse 7, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, that the King of glory shall come in." Man viewed apart from God is an incomplete picture. We coming to an abuse of his image, leading to a misunderstanding of himself. If we think about man apart from God, if we think about man apart from what David is saying, we come to that passage that we've already read, that I'm a worm, and I'm of no worth, and I'm of no consequence. And some people think about themselves in that way, because they're not viewing themselves as God views them. David says man has been created a little bit lower than God. Man is of worth. He can hold his head high. Even in his sinful state, man still reflects the image of God. How God created man in Genesis chapter 1. The aspects of the original creation are still there, verses 6 to 8 of Psalm 8. They continue on. And we have the allusion here in Psalm 8 of Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 to 28. The role of man is to rule and to subdue the earth. You made him a ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds, all beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, and all that swim in the paths of the sea. Man is to rule and to subdue the earth. All the things that God has put in creation, man is to understand that. He is to investigate it. He is to see what God has put there. It's a treasure hunt. What has God done in his creation? How can I understand that? And he is to subdue it. He's to bring order to it. He's to understand it. He's to investigate it. But he's also to rule and have dominion over it. And that was the original creation command that God gave to man. Man is God's representative or agent. He's given the task of structuring creation in such a way that it will manifest God's glory, that it will show who God actually is. He is to subdue or put all things under his feet. An understanding of the created world to study and to investigate in light of truth. Man is still to do that. He is to work it in the broad sense, structuring and caring for it. Man is to make a name for God by finding out what God has done in his creation, by seeing what God has placed there, by looking into the creation and finding all the mysteries that God has placed there. Man is to make a name for God as he reveals the things that God has done. But man in his sin makes a name for himself. That's what was happening in Genesis chapter 11 when they started to build the Tower of Babel. Their desire was to make a name for themselves, and God brought them down. Man is still of worth. He is still got dignity. He has a contribution to make. He still reflects the image of God. David says, man is created a little lower than God. This is the framework in which God sees man. Man is worth dying for. That's who we are. That's why we celebrate the Lord's table. Because God looks at us and he loves his creation. And as we chose to go a different path there in Genesis chapter 3, God says, I have a plan. I have a promise in Genesis chapter 3, the first mention of the gospel. I will put enmity between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, and I will bring a restoration. I will bring people back to myself. So by the time you come to Revelation chapter 21 and 22, you have a new creation. And as we have accepted the work of Jesus Christ on the cross for us, we become that new creation. And those that have passed on, they are already in the presence of God, and they will be given new bodies as we will be given new bodies, and we will be able to enjoy the life that God intended for us in Genesis chapter 1 throughout all eternity, because he's going to come full circle. And he's going to bring a new creation, and the old will pass away, and all things will become new. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 5 says, for unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world to come, wherefore we speak. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. In Christ, through his death, through his resurrection, he's crowned with glory and honor, and we reign with him. We reign with him. David says, that's who we are. What is man? Worth dying for. And Jesus did. And that work on the cross is available to us to bring restoration to us, to bring us back to where God wants us to be. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this psalm. We thank you for David. We thank you for the immersing that he had in creation and that caused him to think about you. And in thinking about you, it caused him to think about who he was. And Father, this morning, even as we will celebrate your table this morning, and as we will share in the elements, it's because of that question, what is man, that thou art mindful of him, the Son of Man, that you care for him. And who we are your children, worth dying for. And for that we praise you and we give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he blessed it and he gave it to his disciples. And our brother will give thanks for the cup, for the bread. Sorry.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your sacrifice for us, Lord, in remembering us, Lord, and not forgetting us even when you're on the cross. It was all because of that split second in eternity that you shaped our destinies and you provided for us, Lord, in your love and your grace and your mercy. Not a bone was broken, Lord, but your body was torn and left on the cross as our living sacrifice, Lord, because you are alive now, Lord, and resurrected. And for that, we give praise and glory. Just help us to remember it now as we come to your communion table, Lord, of your body broken for us.
And he also took the cup and he shared it with his disciples and he asked them to drink of that. And our brother will thank the Lord for the cup.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for taking our sins. Our sins held you on that cross, not the nails, Lord. And if we take this cup, remember the blood that was spilled on that cross for our sins, so Lord, that you loved us so incredibly much that you would die for us, Lord. And as we take this cup, we just remember that sacrifice that you did for each one of us. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
So the deacons will distribute the cups, and as you've become familiar with, the wafer is on top, and the juice, the symbol of Christ's blood, is underneath, and we'll partake together, so we'll wait till everyone gets it, and then take off the first layer for the wafer.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "This is my body given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." He said, this is my blood. Drink in remembrance of me. What is man that thou art mindful of him? The son of man, the daughter of man, that you care for him. Father, we thank you that you care. We thank you that you loved us. We thank you that you went to Calvary for us, and we thank you of these symbols, these things that remind us of your body given for us and your blood spilled for us. And we just thank you for your sacrifice for us. And we do this in remembrance of you until you come. In Jesus' name, amen. Above all, let us see your beauty even in the brokenness of our brothers and sisters, all of them created in your image, and waiting to experience that redemption that comes only through Christ Jesus our Lord. We go now to love and serve our Lord. Amen.